tell. If I could make it off to the freeway, I can get where I'm going.
Life has a way of turning sharply and going in a different direction than what you're steering it. And no matter how hard you slam on the brakes and try to turn the wheel back the other way, your life continues down a road in which you never wanted to go. I could say that I'm bitter. I could say that I'm kicking myself over and over for the mistakes I've made. But the truth is, I don't have time to dwell on the past, because my present day is very demanding and very needed, and it's my responsibility to feed her. Bye, baby. Be good for Nana, I said, taking my 2-year-old daughter Eve into my arms and hugging her tightly.
I come too,
she said, beginning to get herself worked up. I exhaled, putting her down on her feet. I hated working so much. I felt like a horrible mother. My baby missed me so much, and it broke my heart each day I had to pry her little fingers from around my legs. Not this time, baby. Mama got to go to work. When I come home, I will bring you a freeze pop back. She pressed herself up against my leg. She wasn't having it.
No!
She started to whine in her little toddler voice. Y'all, I held back tears. I was under so much pressure, I thought that throwing a tantrum sounded so good right now. Baby, please. Mama gonna bring you the red one like you like, I told her, my voice quivering slightly. How had I come to this? I had so many dreams. I wanted to do so many things. I never imagined I would be flipping burgers for a living. And when I wasn't doing that, I was frying chicken down at Chucky's Chicken Shack. I worked at the burger joint every day from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. Then I came home to have lunch with my baby girl and my nana before I caught the bus to work at Chucky's from 6 p.m. to midnight. This was my daily routine, except on Wednesday. That's when I got a break and could do what I love. I had picked up teaching Nana's dance class down at the center, since she hasn't been feeling up to leaving the house these days. Oh, God. What did I do to deserve this?
Please, Mama. Let me go with you.
I squeezed my eyes shut. You can't give up. You can't give up. Your Nana and your baby girl are depending on you. Come on now, Eve, Nana said, walking slowly through the kitchen door. It pained me to see her like this. All those years of dancing had taken a toll on her body. She once walked with the grace of a swan. And for as long as I can remember, she instilled in me how to glide instead of walk. Now she walked, hunched over, with a cane. Arthritis being her constant tormentor. Thank God for Stormy. She had got one of her friends to make a liniment for my Nana, and it worked like magic. But my Nana was too proud to keep asking for refills. She hated bugging Stormy more than anything because she had already done so much for us in the center. If not for her, both the boarding house and the center would have been long gone by now. Nana hated feeling like a burden, and so did I, which is why I worked the way that I did. I had to make sure our bills were paid and that we could afford the little food we had.
Mama!
Eve yelled out as Nana pulled her away from my leg. Go on, child. This baby be okay. I'll put on her movies. Works every time. I kissed my grandmother on her cheek. Thank you, Nana. I'll bring home some burgers for lunch, and I'll stop by the grocery store and get some things to make chicken salad for dinner. She nodded while holding back Eve, who was now in full tantrum mode. Mama love you, baby, I said to my screaming little girl. I had to hurry and leave the house. Oh, boy. That tore me up every day. And as I stood at the bus stop waiting on the 14, I couldn't help but reflect over my life and how drastically it had changed over the last couple years. How drastically it had changed after that night. I had been on top of the world back then. I had brought down the man responsible for my brother's death. I had been accepted into Juilliard. My grandmother had been so proud of me, and that really was all that mattered. My brother had brought her so much grief. I needed to do the opposite and try to reverse the damage her constant worrying about him had done to her. And for a moment, I had, by being a straight-A student and graduating as valedictorian of my class. Oh yes, I had been on top of the world, but it crumbled right underneath my feet when my actions of that night caught up with me. I walked across the stage 3 months pregnant. And of course, when I called my counselor at Juilliard and explained the situation to her in hopes they would hold my scholarship, she pretty much told me, tough break, and that they would be giving my scholarship to someone else. I begged her with everything I had, ensuring her that I could be a mom and a student at the same time. And you know what, y'all? I'll never forget what she told me. Monica, I'm real sorry. It's just that there are so many young, talented people waiting to fill that spot. And we have found that single parents cannot set aside the time needed to pass your courses. I'm so sorry. You are so talented. It really is a waste. So careless she was in flushing my dreams, my goals, my aspirations down the toilet. I struggled with my feelings toward the child I carried in my womb during pregnancy. This was my enemy's child. I debated whether to get an abortion, but then I thought of my mom and how hard she worked to take care of me and my brother. She could have aborted us. Like me, she had dreams of following in my grandmother's footsteps. Instead, she got pregnant with my brother, then me shortly afterwards, and ended up dancing on a pole because she chose our lives over her dreams. It wasn't this innocent baby's fault that I made some very dumb decisions. Why should she have to pay with her life? So, I chose to have my enemy's child, and it was the best thing I have ever done. I can't imagine my life without Eve. She's the smartest, prettiest baby in the whole world, and she wants to dance just like her mama. And for a 2-year-old, she was pretty good at it. I always took her to class with me on Wednesdays. And you know what? I didn't make it, but I was determined to make sure she does. If it's the last thing I do, I was going to see to it that she made it all the way to the top. After leaving the burger joint, I took the bus to the grocery store and grabbed a few items, mainly salad. I felt horrible because money was so tight, we ate a lot of burgers and fried chicken. But I made sure to serve veggies with every meal. When I got home, I made a chicken salad and put it in the fridge for their dinner later, and a garden salad to go with our burgers for lunch. After putting Eve in her high chair, I plopped down in the chair across from hers and rested my head against my palm. You tired, baby? Nana asked. I could hear the strain in her voice. She was so sick. I was so worried about her. I sat up straight in my chair. Heck no, these little jobs ain't nothing, I lied. Like Stormy was so fond of saying, I was as tired as a Hebrew slave. The ones that were in ancient Egypt and those that are here in America today. But my granny didn't need to know all that. You're a good girl, baby. Taking care of your old grandma like you do? She picked at her salad. I frowned at her. You not hungry, I asked? She shook her head. I ain't had much of an appetite of late. That's it, Nana. I'm taking you to the county on Wednesday. I put down my fork and handed Eve her sippy cup. Psst, child, I ain't going down there to that county hospital to wait 80 years for some white man to pick and poke at me. I'm just fine. Yeah, but you're not just fine. At least let Stormy's friend, Sophia, y'all, come and see you. She waved her hand. Mon, I'm old. This is what old age looks like. We don't need to bother Stormy and her family no more. She stirred some honey in her teacup. Shoo, that man of hers already coming out his pocket to feed them kids. Now that the damn government got rid of our lunch program. She began to cough, reaching for her napkin. You have any idea how much that costs? She continued when she could speak again. If not for Stormy and Solomon, this house that my husband built for me with his bare hands will be gone. They paid the taxes on this place for the next 10 years. I can't keep asking those folks for stuff. She began coughing again because she was getting herself worked up. Okay, Nana. Just calm down. We don't have to ask them for no more money. I make enough to handle things around here. I lied again. My Nana's precious home was deteriorating around us. Everything was wrong with it. It needed a new roof, pipes, and floor. And I didn't even know where to begin. I had gotten a book on plumbing from the library and I was trying to do some of the work myself. I wasn't making much progress though. Well, leaving out for my second job was always easy because I would give Eve a bag of animal crackers when it was time. That plus Sesame Street made for a clean getaway, free of tantrums. I exhaled when I got off the bus in front of Chuck. Chucky paid cash, and the pay wasn't bad either. It was $250 a week, which was awesome. However, Chucky was an old pimp or something that thought he was God's gift to women. Monica, bring your fine A in here and make me some money, he said as soon as I came into the kitchen. Dang, y'all don't know how much I hated hearing that nigga speak. It was gonna be a long night. I locked the doors as soon as 12 o'clock hit. 20 minutes later, I was at the bus stop. I hated being out this late. This was such a bad neighborhood, and the only folks out at this hour was either high or drunk or both. I tightened my grip on my book bag straps. None of these bastards better even try to mess with me tonight, because my feet hurt and I wasn't in the mood. They were going to get cussed out for real. A black Cadillac truck with darkly tinted windows pulled up in front of me, cutting off my view from the rest of the street. Oh, I really wasn't in the mood for this. I tossed my long locks over my shoulder and craned my neck to see if the bus was coming. I'm telling you, this fool better be ready to take no for an answer. No, I didn't have a man. No, I didn't need a man. And hell no, I wasn't looking for a friend. The back door opened and a giant of a man stepped out. I was so caught up in trying to comprehend just how big he was that I didn't notice the two men quickly approaching me from behind. By the time I saw them, it was too late. They moved so fast, I could barely catch my breath. I opened my mouth to scream, but a rag was quickly stuffed in it before they roughly duct taped it around my mouth and head. It pulled viciously at my locks. I went to swing, but the big guy caught my hand and turned me so that both were behind my back. Then quickly secured a plastic tie around them, pulling it tight. I screamed into the rag from the pain, but it did no good. My mouth was tied so tight that only a muffle came out. In front of me stood the two men that snuck up on me. I saw now that they had been in a separate vehicle. I was trying to see if I recognized them from around the hood. If you've seen one thug, you've seen them all. I kicked out at the one who wore his hat cocked to the right. My gym shoe caught him right in the shin. Bitch, he hissed before he punched me in my mouth. I flinched from the pain while trying to fight unconsciousness. What the hell you doing? The big guy said, shoving the man away from me. This kicked me, he snapped, shoving the big guy's hand off him. Let's go. We don't have time for this, another man yelled from the front seat of the Cadillac truck. Then everything went black as one of them put a dark sack over my head. The breath was slammed out of me when someone put their shoulder in my stomach before lifting me. I went wild, trying to wiggle out of their grasp. But seconds later, I was being put into what I was sure was a trunk. I brought my legs up to try to keep the trunk from closing. Someone roughly grabbed my legs, bringing them together before tying my ankles together with another plastic pot. Then they threw my legs down and slammed the trunk. Oh my God. I was being kidnapped. My heart pounded so hard in my chest, I was having a hard time breathing. I had never been so afraid in my life. I was getting ready to die, or worse, I was getting ready to be raped or sold into slavery. Nana was always watching the news. She was just telling me yesterday that there had been an increase in black women and girls being kidnapped and sold as sex slaves. Oh no, I was getting ready to be sold as a sex slave. And then a thought crossed my mind that made me freeze in terror. Organ harvesting. Nana said that they were kidnapping black folks for their organs as well. Tears came to my eyes. I was screaming so much my throat got sore. I could feel my wrist being scraped raw from where I had pulled against the plastic tie trying to break it. I didn't care about the pain. I just wanted to be free. I thought about Eve and Nana. They needed me. I could not die. Who would take care of them if I died? We drove for about 30 to 45 minutes before the car came to a stop. I was so scared, I was shaking. I still couldn't breathe, and my busted lip felt swollen and sore. The trunk opened, and I was roughly lifted out and stood upon my feet. My teeth began to chatter. Dear Yah, help me. I prayed to Stormy's God, because she said he had saved her life, so maybe he could save mine right now. The bag was yanked off my head. I blinked, trying to take in my surroundings. Judging by the tubes and the smell of oil and gasoline, I was in a warehouse or a garage. It was full of classic cars. I continued scanning the place, trying to catch my breath until my eyes landed on the face that had haunted my dreams. I sharply inhaled, feeling as if the wind had been knocked completely out of me. Dear Yah, it was Caleb. He smiled wickedly at me from where he stood surrounded by his men. The giant that had stepped out of the Calac was next to him. Amazingly, although that man was clearly bigger than him, his girth was not enough to overshadow Caleb's might. Just like the first time I saw him, power seemed to just radiate from him. He wore it well. There was no question who was king here. Dressed in all black again, he sported jeans and a t-shirt that lay on his muscle chest just right, showing that he was very well built beneath his clothes. And like the first time I saw him, he wore a pair of black boots on his feet. Unlike the first time, he now sported a full beard on his handsome face. So many questions raced through my mind at this moment. When had he gotten out? How had he gotten out? The last I heard, he had been facing 20 years for tax evasion or something like that. It was a little unnerving that none of the drug charges stuck. Still, I was thrilled to learn that they had found something to get him on. And for 20 years? That made it all worth it for me. Of course I heard that through the grapevine. Not that I didn't do all I could to get better information. It's just that some information was hard to come by, even when calling and pretending to be an attorney interested in the case. His eyes slowly raked down my body. He lifted his hand and someone yanked the tape from behind my head. I closed my eyes, flinching as the tape was snatched off my sore mouth, my wound being reopened in the process. The man from the front seat came around and took the cloth out of my mouth. I sucked in my bottom lip, trying to feel how much damage had been done to it. Oh, yeah, it was definitely busted. I looked at the punk who hit me, and for a moment, anger took over my fear. However, that fear quickly rushed back in when Caleb began to move towards me. His eyes narrowed on my lip. He lifted my face with his finger, looking at my busted lip. "Who hit you?" he asked quietly. His deep voice was so deadly. I was so scared, with him being so close to me and touching me, that for the life of me, I could not speak. He turned around and looked at his man. "Who hit her?" His deep voice filled the huge garage. The thug that hit me stepped up. I did, Kay." His voice shook a little. Caleb looked at him for a minute before he held back his head and laughed. But it was something about that laugh that was bone chilling. And I wasn't the only one that thought so either, because all his men except for the giant began to fidget, especially the guy who hit me. "Kay, man, she kicked me," the man said, trying to explain his actions. "Oh, she kicked you?" Caleb cooed, as if he was talking to a small child. As he walked slowly toward him, the guy began to frantically look around at the other men for help. "Caleb, man, I'm sorry," he began, but before he could finish, Caleb moved quickly, grabbing two mammoth-sized wrenches from a nearby table. What he did with them next caused me to open my mouth with a scream frozen in my throat as I stared in horror. He brought one wrench up with a mighty blow, catching the man with such force underneath his chin, he flew up in the air. Before he came down with the other wrench on top of his head, causing his dead body to crash to the floor with his head split open from the impact. Caleb threw both wrenches down at the lifeless body hard. "Kick that, punk," he said to the body, shaking his head. And it was right then I realized that I was dealing with a cold-blooded killer. When he looked back at me, that scream escaped. I turned and tried to run, remembering too late that my ankles were tied. Another scream escaped my throat as I tipped over, getting ready to hit the floor. Because my hands were still tied behind my back, I couldn't even bring them out to stop my fall. The giant reached out and grabbed my arm, preventing my fall, but leaving me slightly suspended in the air from where I still tipped forward.
"Where you going, baby? I was just getting ready to invite you to dinner,"
Caleb said, coming to stand in front of me. He wrapped one arm around my waist and snatched me up against him. The breath slammed out of me at the impact of our bodies suddenly coming into contact.
"Surely, you won't be so rude as to leave without first having dinner, or even saying goodbye."
The anger that came from his eyes was real. Oh my goodness, what had I done getting entangled with this maniac? I lit my dry lips and winced when my tongue came across my wound. His eyes followed before he slowly lifted me up his big body, bringing my mouth close enough for him to gently kiss my wound. A quiver shot through my body. I sucked in my breath, taken off guard by my body's response to his soft caress.
"I'm sorry about that," he whispered, before he gently kissed me one more time. "A man that hit a woman ain't sh—"
And I could tell that he meant what he said.
"Even a treacherous woman that will give a man her virginity to set him up and get it thrown into prison,"
he continued just as quietly, still holding me close. I opened my mouth to say something to defend myself. I thought about lying and acting like I had no idea what he was talking about. But then I remembered what I had just witnessed. He had brutally killed a man. Yet, as easily as one would put on a pair of shoes. I began, but I was so scared I couldn't think of what to follow that with. "I'm sorry, perhaps?"
"You what?"
he asked, his eyes raking over my face. I felt as if he could see into my soul.
"Come on, you beautiful little liar. Surely you can bring something to those treacherous lips of yours."
I was shaking so bad, I think my teeth were chattering.
"Have dinner with me," he spoke softly, his hungry gaze still on my mouth.
"I don't want to," I managed to get out, barely over whispered. His gaze left my mouth and slowly traveled up my face to my eyes before going to my hair, my nose, and my neck. The way he looked at me made me remember that night, how he had touched my body, how he had kissed my body. It made me remember how he had taken me over and over, waking my body up to the pleasures of the touch of a man without mercy. It made me remember how I had begged him to let me rest because I felt as if I would die if he caused my body to shatter one more time, only for him to show me that, no, I would not die.
I insist.
He spoke suddenly before letting my body slide down his until my feet were once again planted on the floor. Then he squatted down right in front of me. My breath froze in my throat because his face was so close to my center. I closed my eyes, too afraid to look down to see what he was doing. Was he going to rape me? Oh my goodness, was he going to rape me in front of all his men? But seconds later, I felt the tie give away from my ankle. I exhaled. He stood looking down at me as he used the knife to cut the tie from around my wrist as well. The way he watched me as he did it let me know he was aware of my thoughts. There was activity going on around us, but I couldn't look away from his gaze. I rubbed my sore wrist. He took a few steps back and I blinked twice, seeming to come from under whatever power his gaze had just had over me. I looked around and I saw several waitstaff setting up a table for two. His men were gone. I frowned, turning where I stood. They were all gone. They had taken the body of the guy who had hit me with them. There was no evidence that he had ever been here. Not one drop of blood. What the world? My gaze flew back to Caleb, who stood there smiling at me as if he could hear my thoughts. Oh man, I had to get away from him. He held too much power over me. See, I had convinced myself that the only reason that night had happened the way that it did was because I had been drugged. And if not for the drugs, I would have never given myself to him. But now I know that I had lied to myself. When he held me in his arms and his gaze, he had a power to make everything else just disappear.
Please, sit, he said, holding out one of the chairs at the beautiful table for me.
I stood there wondering what I should do. I looked around. The big garage was now empty. It was just me and him. Where had all the waitstaff gone? I bit my lip and flinched from the pain. Goodness, I forgot it was damaged. But I was so nervous. I didn't know what to do.
Come on, sweetheart. Have a seat.
He spoke softly, but there was something in his voice that said his patience was wearing thin. I inhaled and slowly walked to the chair. After I sat, he gave my chair a little push up to the table. Then he reached past me, taking the metal dome off my plate before he turned and handed it to a waiter that seemed to just appear out of nowhere. Then he walked around and took his seat in the chair across from mine. The table wasn't that big, so when he sat, I felt his long legs open to the side of both of mine.
I don't know about you, but I'm starving.
He removed the dome from his dinner and handed it to the server. Another server came to the table with a bottle of wine and poured us both a glass. Another came and placed a glass of brown liquor on the table next to Caleb's wine.
Would you like something else besides the wine? I'm a cognac man myself,
he said as he picked up his fork and knife and began to cut into his steak. The server stood waiting for my answer. I shook my head. No, thank you. My voice was hoarse from all the screaming I had done tonight. The server nodded and disappeared as quietly as he came. I looked across the table at Caleb, with my hands in my lap.
Aren't you gonna eat?
He asked, putting a piece of steak in his mouth with his fork. I shook my head. I'm not hungry.
Did you eat some chicken?
He asked with a grin on his face, his gaze falling to my Chuck E. Cheese Chicken Shack shirt. Wow, look at that. The killer had jokes. And let me tell you, had I not just witnessed him kill a man effortlessly with two big King Kong-sized wrenches, I would have given him a piece of my mind for teasing me about my job. I nodded instead. Yeah, I ate chicken. I saw no need to pretend that I was happy to be here. He paused in eating to look at me with those dark eyes of his. I tried not to squirm underneath his gaze. When he looked at me like that, it made me feel aware that yes, I was sitting here in my Chuck E. Chicken Shack uniform, that it had been a while since I touched up my locks and probably looked as haggard as I felt.
You sure?
He asked.
These are Mama Rita's steaks.
Oh, man. For the first time, I looked down at my plate. Mama Rita's? Everybody in the hood knew about Mama Rita's steaks. It's just that you had to be hood rich to buy one. Right then, my stomach let out a crazy growl. Well, damn. Thanks, stomach. I guess I could have a little taste, I told him, picking up my knife and fork. You see, I had a Mama Rita steak once. Stormy had treated me to lunch at Mama Rita's restaurant, and I promise, it was the best thing I ever tasted in my life. The knife slid smoothly through the meat. I cut a small piece and, using my fork, put it between my lips, careful not to touch the sore one. Oh, it just melted in my mouth. I don't know if I moaned out loud to myself, but dang, this steak was fire! You can taste the charbroiled, butter, garlicky goodness in every bite. I cut another piece. I don't know the last time I ate something so tasty. He joked about me eating chicken, but it was the truth. I ate fried chicken every day. I cut another piece and lifted the steak to my mouth. Right then, I looked across the table and froze when I saw him staring back at me. The look on his face was all kind of inappropriateness. What? I asked before putting the steak in my mouth.
I see you found your appetite.
I shrugged, cut another piece of steak. Who was I trying to impress? Who knows when I get another Mama Rita steak, sure. Only a fool will let a Mama Rita steak go to waste, I told him around a mouthful of steak. He nodded.
You ain't lying. For 2 years I sat in prison, counting days to my release, for two things. One of which was a Mama Rita steak.
Something in his voice made me lose my appetite. Here it is. We have come to the turning point of our meeting. I lay my knife and fork down on the table before picking up my napkin and gently wiping my mouth. Carefully, I placed it on the table. After taking a deep breath, I looked over at him. He too had stopped eating. His angry gaze washed over me like an inferno. And the other, I asked. He grinned slightly and he gave me chills.
Well, you see, the other thing I wanted more than I wanted this here steak, the other thing I dreamed about every night.
He paused for just a moment before he continued.
I couldn't wait until I was free so that I can get my hands on you.
Pure rage came from his eyes in that moment. I did what came natural, which was to turn and run. Quickly I stood. But just as quickly, he grabbed my wrist, pulling me back down and halfway across the table so that our lips were almost touching. My wine and water glasses crashed to the floor. I winced from where he grabbed my sore wrist. He turned to look at my wrist, and for the first time, he noticed they were red from where the tie had rubbed them raw. Slowly, he brought my wrist to his mouth and softly kissed where it hurt. I almost moaned. Every time his lips touched me, my body had a startling response. Then he turned to look back into my eyes, his angry gaze reminding me he was a killer.
You took 2 years of my life. Why? He growled through clenched teeth.
I flinched from the force of his anger.
What did I do to you? Who sent you after me?
The muscle ticked furiously in his cheek. Tears came to my eyes. I was so taken back by his anger that the only thing I could do was cry.
Answer me, damn it, he yelled at me.
You killed my brother, I yelled at the top of my lungs. A look of shock crossed his face. He loosened his grip on my wrist, and I snatched it away from him, falling back into my chair. He sat back in his chair, frowning at me.
Who is your brother?
Man-Man, I told him, rubbing my wrist.
Man-Man?
He looked confused. Right then, pure hatred washed over me. This bastard. This bastard didn't even have the decency to remember my brother. I stood angrily.
Sit down, Monica, he said heatedly.
No, I'm leaving. We're done here. He moved then, bringing his fist down so hard on the table, almost everything on it crashed to the ground. "Sit down!" he roared, and I ain't gonna lie, he just scared the hell out of me. I went on and sat down, looking at him with wide eyes.
"We are not done until I say we are."
Each word he spoke was accompanied by a finger jab on the already weakened table.
"You are responsible for me losing 2 years of my life, rotting in jail. The only reason you ain't dead now is because I want something from you in exchange for the time that I lost."
I swallowed, my throat suddenly going dry. "What do you want?" My question was barely over a whisper. He sat back in his chair, resting his elbows on the arms while crossing his fingers in front of his mouth. He looked off into the distance and chuckled.
"For so long, I fought a battle in my head debating if you were even real."
His deep, penetrating gaze came back to me.
"You see, your lips have been the sweetest I have ever tasted. And what are the odds of sipping such nectar right before my world begins to crash in around me?"
His fingers slowly rubbed across his bottom lip as he spoke.
"A lot of things have changed in my life over the last 2 years, but one thing has not. In fact, it has only grown with each passing day."
I swallowed again. "What's that?" I asked, but I was terrified of the answer. He moved suddenly, sitting up in his chair and coming to the edge of it, bringing him closer. He leaned on the table.
"My hunger for that nectar."
He grinned so wickedly, my breath got caught somewhere between my throat and my lips. His eyes lowered to them.
"I want more."
He spaced those three words out, emphasizing each syllable.
"You took 2 years of my life. In exchange, I want 2 years of yours. You will be at my beck and call. I work hard. I need someone to look after my basic needs."
"Basic needs?" That devious grin on his face.
"You know, a good meal, a nice warm body in my nice warm bed, and full access to that sweet nectar."
I frowned at him. "It sounds to me like you need to find yourself a wife, brother." I intentionally used the W word. Madam Queen said that was the quickest way to get a man to run for the door. Yet, that grin was still there on his face. It had not faltered.
"You know what? You're right. That's exactly what you'll be for the next 2 years."
My mouth dropped open. That was not the way he was supposed to respond. "Man, you tripping," I told him. "I got responsibilities. I got bills. I can't just drop everything and cater to you." I didn't care if I was talking reckless. At this point, I didn't care if he picked up one of those giant wrenches and split my head open the way he had just done that poor bastard earlier.
"Yes, you can. And you will. You're done at the chicken joint in the burger shack. At least for the next 2 years. However, if you do a good job, be a good girl for daddy, I'll leave you straight. So you won't have to go back to work again, if you don't choose to."
I narrowed my eyes at him. "It's the chicken shack and the burger joint," I corrected him, not caring if I sounded petty. He chuckled.
"It doesn't matter."
This mother Foster, how damn dare he talk to me like I'm some whore. First he kills my brother, then he acts like he doesn't even remember. He seduces me, gets me pregnant, destroying all my dreams of dancing on Broadway. Then he gets his punk self out of jail 18 years early, kidnaps me, and then turns around and demands I be his paid whore for the next 2 years. "And if I say no?" I asked. He chuckled again.
"Oh, that's simple. I destroy you and all those you hold dear."
I nodded. Yep, I pretty much knew he was going to say something like that.
Okay, well, what choice do I have? I told him. But you see, I had already started planning. No, I couldn't beat him strength-wise. The man was a brute. And no, I didn't have an army to go to war with him. I had something far more deadly. You see, if nothing else, I am astute. And astute people always find a way to fight back. He narrowed his eyes at me. Do you know why I approached you that night at the party? He asked. His question caused me to pause. It is something I have been wondering about for the last 2 years. For the life of me, I couldn't figure it out. I, by no means, was the star of the party. In fact, I hid myself so deep in the corner, I was surprised he had saw me at all. I shook my head.
I saw you at the party, and although you put on a fine show, that wasn't what I noticed about you.
He leaned close again, his deep gaze doing that thing he did, making me feel as if he could see me.
I saw your fear. I saw that you were uncomfortable dressed the way that you were. I could smell your innocence. I knew that you were unlike any other girl there, and I had to see for myself. I had to see if you were as innocently sweet as you look.
He sat back in his chair.
I see your brain working, Mom. You have got it in your mind that you're going to fight me.
He smiled.
I welcome the challenge, sweetheart.
He stood and crossed the space between us. Bending down, he wrapped one arm around my waist, pulling me up out the chair.
But you should know, I will not be denied what I have come to crave.
His eyes fell to my lips, and he dipped his head and kissed me gently, being very careful of my hurt lip. I did groan then. I couldn't help it.
Come on, let's get you home.
Panic shot through me. Home? Eve was home. Oh my goodness, I couldn't let him find out about Eve. Oh God, why hadn't I thought about this till now? If he found out about Eve, he would have even more control over me. He looked down at me, reading me like a book. Damn, I needed to be on the lookout for that trait of his. He was good at it. I don't need you to take me home. I can just take the bus. I was trying to sound normal and not let the panic bleed through. He looked at me for a minute before he chuckled.
Yeah, right,
was all he said, still chuckling as he took my hand and began to lead me to the only car there that wasn't a classic. In fact, it wasn't a car at all. It was a Land Rover. He opened the passenger door, and I got in, my mind racing, searching for a way out as he walked around the truck and got into the driver's seat. My mind raced as we drove. It was racing so much I didn't realize he had not once asked me where I lived. Yet here we were, pulling up in front of my house. Now that I thought about it, he knew a lot about me, including where I worked. He killed the engine. Can I ask you something? I said, without turning to look at him. I stared straight ahead.
Yep,
he said back in his seat. How come you know where I live and where I work? He didn't say anything. I turned to look at him then, his intense gaze penetrating through the darkness of the truck. He grinned at me in that wicked way that he does.
I know everything about you.
He spoke quietly. I looked at him, schooling my features, being very careful not to give away my mind. He did know everything about me. I knew for a fact he was unaware of Eve. If he had known of her, this night would have gone completely different. I reached for the doorknob, but I had one more question before I left. How did you get out? I know my question was borderline rude, but I didn't care.
Out of prison, you mean?
I nodded. He smiled.
I had a damn good lawyer.